I was 12 years of age, a friend and I saw Psycho on its first release in Melbourne, Australia. Our parents thought it wasn't suitable for us, so we thought that was a good enough reason to go, and we saw it once, and then I think we found a back way into the theatre and snuck in another four times. We're not making a sequel just because it was a successful Hitchcock film. We're making a sequel because we think there's more story to tell about Norman Bates. The most unique thing to me about Psycho, and I hope we've captured the same thing, was the tone of the original film. Norman Bates didn't even know he was a killer, and we felt great sympathy for him.
Mother! Oh, God! Mother! Blood! Blood!
You could watch 100 slasher movies without ever finding a killer as sympathetic as Norman Bates. Robert Block, his creator, envisioned him as an overweight, middle-aged loon, much more in keeping with the real-life butcher of Plainfield, Ed Gein. It was the genius of Alfred Hitchcock to turn him into a young, handsome, deceptively normal man you might want to take home to mother. Bates stands out in a sea of maniacs. Michael and Jason were silent bogeymen. Freddy was a spectre tethered to our dreams. And Hannibal was so over the top that his cell became the equivalent of an old Transylvanian castle. And that's where Bates comes in. He's not only as horrified by his crimes as we are, but he also regrets them. ''1960s Psycho has been discussed and dissected to death, and it won't be our primary focus today. But it does introduce us to Norman and his fondly remembered avatar, Anthony Perkins. What follows is an analysis of how Hitchcock established Bates as a character, and how that foundation was used to create one of the most overlooked sequels in cinematic history, Psycho 2. The 1983 follow-up regularly impresses those actually willing to give it a chance, and most unexpectedly of all, it gives us a mystery to solve. How many slasher movies can say that? Even more unique is the way it humanizes its title monster to the point of making us feel sorry for him. To further demonstrate how good a continuation this is, we're going to present Psycho 2 in black and white. It is tough to imagine anyone being unfamiliar with Hitchcock's classic, but we should recount the necessary facts.
Good afternoon. Here we have a quiet little motel. Tucked away off the main highway, and as you see, perfectly harmless looking, when in fact, it has now become known as the scene of the crime. This motel also has, as an adjunct, an old house, which is, if I may say so, a little more sinister looking, less innocent than the motel itself. And in this house, the most dire, horrible events took place.
In the small fictional town of Fairvale, California, Norman Bates runs the Bates Motel, which has been left to rot when the proposed highway was built elsewhere. Its seclusion makes it the perfect spot for a killer hiding in plain sight.
Oh, we have 12 vacancies. 12 cabins, 12 vacancies. They moved away the highway.
Oh, I thought I'd gotten off the main road.
I knew you must have. Nobody ever stops here anymore unless they've done that.
For the first act of the film, we follow Janet Leigh's Marion Crane, herself carrying a dark secret, who soon discovers that checkout times at the Bates Motel are earlier than expected. Her death, supposedly at the hands of an old crone, shifts the focus to Bates, who seems to live in fear of his dear old mother, who is always watching from her bedroom window. After we see him dispose of Marion's remains, the film becomes Norman's, and this seamless transition is a true testament to Hitchcock's abilities. We assume his mother has done the deed, so when we see Marion's car taking slightly too long to sink into the swamp, we begin to fear for the young man's future. This is followed by a sigh of relief as the vehicle finally gurgles into the depths. Likewise, we are concerned for Norman when Marion's boyfriend Sam Loomis, as well as her sister Lila, come looking for answers.
Yes, miss?
I'm Marion's sister.
Sure, Lila.
Is Marion here?
Of course not.
Thank you.
Something wrong?
She left home on Friday. I was in Tucson over the weekend, and I haven't heard from her since. Not even a phone call.
Compounding this is the presence of a private investigator, Arbogast, whose introductory shot is so strangely uncomfortable that we immediately think of him as an antagonist.
See, I'm looking for a missing person. My name's Arbogast. I'm a private investigator. I've been trying to trace a girl that's been missing for about a week now from Phoenix. It's a private matter. The family wants to forgive her. She's not in any trouble.
I didn't think the police went looking for people who aren't in trouble.
Oh, I'm not the police.
Oh, yeah?
We have reason to believe that she came along this way, may have stopped in the area. Did she stop here?
Well, no one stopped here for a couple of weeks.
Do you mind looking at the picture before committing yourself?
Commit myself? You sure talk like a policeman. She might have fooled me, but she didn't fool my mother.
Well, then your mother met her. Could I talk to your mother?
No, as I told you, she's confined.
Yes, but just for a few minutes, that's all. There might be some hint that you missed out on. You know, sick old women are usually pretty sharp.
Mr. Arbogast.
I won't disturb you.
I think I've talked to you all I want to.
Yes, but just for...
I think it'd be much better if you left now. Thanks.
Very few probably watch the film today not knowing that the murders are Norman's handiwork, and he has been assuming the guise of his stern, domineering mother, long dead by her son's hands. This is clarified in Psycho's single bad scene, a late in the game wrap-up by a doctor explaining his impulses to a confused 60s audience.
Now, to understand it the way I understood it, hearing it from the mother, that is, from the mother half of Norman's mind, you have to go back 10 years to the time when Norman murdered his mother and her lover. Now, he was already dangerously disturbed, had been ever since his father died. His mother was a clinging, demanding woman. And for years, the two of them lived as if there was no one else in the world. Then she met a man. And it seemed to Norman that she threw him over for this man. Now that pushed him over the line and he killed them both. Matricide is probably the most unbearable crime of all. Most unbearable to the son who commits it. So he had to erase the crime. At least in his own mind. He stole her corpse. A weighted coffin was buried. He hid the body in the fruit cellar. Even treated it to keep it as well as it would keep. And that still wasn't enough. She was there. But she was a corpse.
Though Bates shares plenty with the aforementioned Ed Gein, it should surprise many that he wasn't actually inspired by him, at least in full. Gein was a homicidal grave robber with a mother complex, yes, but psychonovelist Robert Bloch maintained that many of the brushstrokes were coincidental. Gein had let his farmhouse fester, apart from his mother's room, which was as spotless as the day she died, and he collected human remains to build a woman's suit. Facts you could say are reflected in Norman's cross-dressing, his preservation of Mother's corpse, and his love for taxidermy.
Good afternoon. I see you've all been devouring the article on Mr. Ed Gein. Violent chap, and the real-life inspiration behind Psycho. All of us harbour dark recesses of violence and horror. Fascinating. When the Wisconsin Police Department raided Mr. Gein's farm, they opened the door and voila, they discovered 10 female heads with the top sawn off. Pass these around, would you, and have a look. Masks of human skin, a pair of lips on a drawstring for a window shade. Oh, yes, in a jug containing human noses. And
is this really going to be your next picture, Mr. Hitchcock?
Well, that is my intention, yes, madam. My only wish is that Ed Gein looks a little more like William Holden instead of Elmer Fudd.
Many of the grisly details of the Gein case were only revealed as time went on, however, and were only just becoming common knowledge when the book arrived in 1959. Bloch was alarmed to note many of the similarities left out of those early reports, leading him to question his own sanity in the process.
Do you know what Ed Gein said about women?
Ed Gein, maitre d' at Canal Bar?
No. Serial killer, Wisconsin in the 50s.
What did Ed say?
He said, when I see a pretty girl walking down the street, I think two things. One part of me wants to take her out and talk to her, be real nice and sweet and treat her right.
And what'd the other part of him think?
What her head would look like on a stick.
When Psycho ends on that famous close-up of Perkins smiling a devilish smile, we are in no doubt that Mother has taken over and that Norman is lost forever. No one expected to be revisiting the case 23 years later.
They're probably watching me. Well, let them. Let them see what kind of a person I am. I'm not even going to swat that fly. I hope they are watching. They'll see. They'll see and they'll know, and they'll say, why, she wouldn't even harm a fly.
Ask a person if they've seen Psycho 2, and they usually pull a face as if to say, "Why would I bother with that?" This was probably the general feeling when Universal announced they were returning to the Bates Motel. In fact, producer Hilton A. Green, who had been the assistant director last time, would never have made the project if it hadn't received a blessing from Hitchcock's daughter, Patricia. Hitch had been dead for a mere 3 years at the time of the film's release, and it's safe to say he wouldn't have been okay with anyone playing in his pool. Spurred on by the success of the slasher craze ignited by John Carpenter's Halloween, the time was right, it seemed, to pick up the story of Norman Bates. Original screenwriter Joseph Stefano didn't return, replaced by an up-and-coming Tom Holland. The horror buff would go on to direct genre classics Fright Night and Child's Play, and his sensitive treatment for Psycho 2 ensured that it would be a cut above the rest.
It was planned as a cable movie, and this is just when cable was coming in, and it was co-produced by Oak Communications in San Diego. You'll see it in the credits. And so they were going to produce it as a movie you could put on cable. That's all the Universal thought was worth it. So it was the worth of the Psycho title. So what that presented me and Richard Franklin, the director, with was how to get Tony Perkins to come back as Norman. Because we, not Universal, but Richard and I felt that if we got Tony, there would be enough interest in Psycho 2 that they'd be forced to make a feature film out of it. So the challenge for me was how to write a script as actor bait for Tony Perkins. When Universal announced that Tony was coming back to play Norman, the worldwide international press went crazy. And the reaction was so obvious, and the want to see was so obvious, that Universal finally woke up and realized that it was more than just a cable movie. They gave us almost no money. I think we did it for something like $4.849. And if you put the 10 or 20% overhead, studio overhead on it, it was still like $5.2. So it was like the cheapest movie ever done. It was done like Hitchcock did the original with his television crew.
The plot sees Norman released from his two-decade incarceration after being found not guilty by reason of insanity. He no longer hears Mother's voice, and he manages to convince his doctor, played by Robert Loggia, that he is all better now. Condemning his release is Vera Miles as Lila Loomis, Marion's sister from the original film, who seems to be hell-bent on keeping Bates locked up.
Are you satisfied, Doctor? Turning a murderer loose on an innocent public?
Mrs. Loomis, Norman was not convicted of murder. He was found not guilty by reason of insanity. And since he is no
that
longer
is
insane,
just
he has
legal,
much
hocus,
of a right
hocus
to his own life.
And when
as
he
you
murders
are.
Again, you will be directly responsible.
Her protests are dismissed, and Norman is allowed to return home. The house is discovered exactly as he left it, although the motel is being operated by the repellent Warren Toomey, played with a typical seediness by Dennis Franz.
What's this stuff?
Say it was drugs.
What about the occupied cabins? Is that what's going on in there too?
Yeah. Well, this town, if it isn't the parents, it's the kids. I caught a couple of them screwing in the basement of your house up there last week. Of course, I threw them right out. Can you believe that?
What kind of a motel are you running here?
The kind that makes money.
After a failed attempt to acclimatize to a job at the local diner, Bates fires Toomey for the riffraff he attracts, and intends to reopen the motel himself. He has also sparked a friendship with waitress Mary Samuels, played by Meg Tilly, who is staying with Norman after being rejected by her boyfriend.
I just remembered this girlfriend I have in town. I mean, she's kind of a girlfriend, and maybe she'd let me spend the night with her.
Well, I thought you were going to stay here. There's a spare room upstairs, and you're more than welcome to it.
I don't think that's such a good idea.
Why?
I don't mean to hurt your feelings or anything, but Myrna was talking about you at the diner today. Mrs. Spool kept on telling her to shush, but she wouldn't. She said you'd been locked up.
Did she say why? Well, I'll tell you. When I was 12, my mother went mad. So I put some poison in her tea, you know? I'm all right now.
All seems well, but upon returning to the house, Norman begins to find strange notes left by his mother, and even hears her voice emanating from the bedroom.
Norman! What did you put in my tea? Gonna get you for this, Norman! Gonna show you what happens to bad little boys who poison their mothers!
She played my mother in Walk in the Spring Rain in 1970 or 71. And I didn't know then, but later on when I was working on Psycho 2 and writing it, I found out in the credits she was the voice actor, the voice for Mother. And she was a sensational actress and a terrific person.
It eventually transpires that Mary is the daughter of Lila Loomis, and she has been sent in to spy on the would-be killer. But surely Lila hasn't been committing these murders just to make a point? And was it Norman spying on Mary from a peephole in the bathroom? Or her own mother?
Mother, I was wrong. I don't think he drilled that hole in the bathroom wall.
Of course he did.
Mother, listen to me. I think there's someone else in the house.
Don't be stupid. It's just Bates up to his old tricks again.
It can't be, Norman. He isn't like that anymore. Maybe if you knew him now. It's just that he is trying so very hard to do what's right, to keep his sanity. And it hardly seems fair for us to be doing what we're doing to him.
You're as crazy as he is.
The questions and bodies begin to melt, and it isn't long before Norman is starting to lose his grip on the sanity he so deeply desires.
It's starting again.
I knew that what Hitchcock had done so brilliantly, and Joe Stefano, was that they had made you feel sorry for Norman in the original film. You realized it was very clear that his mother had driven him insane, even though you didn't know why. I was being very, very careful to only work on the given circumstances of the original film. I didn't want to deviate from that at all. I figured it was a defense against the hostility of the critics, or what I assumed would be the hostility.
We get our answers in the final scene when Mrs. Spool, played by Claudia Breyer, arrives at the house to confront Norman. She was set up early in the film as another worker at the diner, and it was Spool leaving the notes and speaking in Mrs. Bates' voice. In a controversial retcon of the story, she reveals herself as Norman's true mother, and she has carried out these murders to bring them closer together.
So, are you really my mother?
The name Spool doesn't mean anything to you?
No, should it?
It was Norma Bates' maiden name. The woman you thought was your mother was my sister. I had you when I was very young, out of wedlock. I couldn't handle a brand new baby, especially being by myself. I had some trouble, and the state put me away for a while.
Bates, now utterly confused, deals with the situation the only way he knows how.
You're sure you won't have a sandwich?
Pardon?
Norman has lost it and claims his first fresh victim only a minute before the credits roll. It all comes full circle. He has control of the motel, and his mother is once again watching from the window. As critic Kim Newman put it, normality can only be restored when Norman starts killing again. Psycho 2 gives you everything you rationally expect from a follow-up to Psycho, but brilliantly keeps you guessing from beginning to end.
Really, Psycho 2 is a tragedy, you know, because Lila succeeds at the end of the movie. She's driven Norman stark raving mad, and he kills his own mother, the first murder he's done in the entire movie. And it's terribly sad, even as it's terrifyingly unexpected. I just figured the critics were gonna tear me apart for even having the temerity to do it for what even by that time was considered a classic. I had to make it sympathetic. I had to make the part a great acting role, and an acting role that, you know, that would move the audience.
Though Tom Holland's script went above and beyond what was expected, Universal were also smart enough to find a director actually suited to the material. Australian filmmaker Richard Franklin made his US debut with the film, and you have to wonder if they could have found anyone better. Franklin, who had just made the Hitchcockian thriller Road Games with Jamie Lee Curtis, was actually a student of the legendary filmmaker and even visited him on the set of 1969's Topaz. Franklin brings a fanboy's understanding to the project, and litters the film with visual echoes of the 1960s classic. Look closely, and you'll even see the familiar Hitchcock silhouettes from his TV series in the shadows.
It was a wonderful experience working with Richard. He believed the two greatest directors were Alfred Hitchcock and John Ford, and he knew everything about both of them. And what we did was we ran every Hitchcock film, including The Silence. We went down to the screening room at Universal in the Valley, San Fernando Valley, and looked at one Hitchcock movie after another. And what we did was we picked out the, what I call, visual set pieces, which is where the movie moves forward with the minimal amount of dialogue, and it's all camera work, which of course was Hitchcock's great talent, and he used it, you know, for suspense. He almost created it, as a matter of fact. Go look at The Lodger. The visuals got more brilliant, you know, the older he got, as he got into his, you know, his great period, you know, North by Northwest and all of that. Richard and I broke down every visual set piece, and certainly everything in Psycho. And we looked at how they'd been visually constructed, what shots Hitchcock had used to, you know, to put them together. The camera moves, they were all spectacular. From that, I learned so much about suspense and how to create suspense, and Hitchcock has become, or was, or is, you know, a huge influence on my own career and what I did in film. And I have Richard Franklin to thank for that.
I was telephoned in Australia about last October, and they said to me, "What do you think of the idea of doing a sequel to Psycho?" I said, "Well, I'm only disappointed that I didn't think of it earlier." And I modeled my own demeanor on Hitchcock in that I tried pre-planning the film in the way that I'd seen him do. That was a film called Patrick, which was a thriller, which won a bunch of awards. And so I guess I figured that approach worked better for me. And so from that time on, I have endeavored to continue to pre-plan in the way that Hitchcock does.
The cinematographer was Dean Cundey, who had won acclaim for filming the Psycho-influenced Halloween. Though filmed in colour, Cundey adeptly uses a muted palette to reflect the film's autumnal outlook. With more money to play with and 2 decades of advancements, Franklin and Cundey also pull off several camera movements Hitchcock would have killed for on his modest production. Though the original Bates house was still standing on the Universal backlot, the motel portion had to be rebuilt from scratch, although eagle-eyed viewers rarely noticed this. Production designer John W. Corso also took the opportunity to expand on areas barely glimpsed in the original film, such as the kitchen, where Bates spends much of his time in the sequel. The town of Fairvale was also on the backlot, and the so-called Courthouse Square would later be used for Kingston Falls in Gremlins and Hill Valley in Back to the Future. Complementing the stately visuals is the beautiful work of veteran composer Jerry Goldsmith, who took over from the late Bernard Herrmann. In what can be considered a truly gutsy move, none of Herrmann's famous themes are used in Psycho 2. Befitting the sequel's tender focus on Norman's evolving mental state, it is less a straight-up horror score, and more of a low-key and melancholic affair. Goldsmith's work can safely sit alongside Herrmann's for having the courage to be different. There are some popular pet peeves, however. Beginning the film with a flashback to the notorious shower sequence feels like a concession to the studio, as does the presence of graphic on-screen gore that makes its 80s origins all too apparent.
So many of the slasher movies by then were you know, seemed popular because of explicit gore. I think we referenced to poke some fun at that at some point with the teenagers. You know, we're in the basement, which was, you know, have sex and get killed. And that was done with a much lighter hand, but the knife through the mouth was definitely a nod to what was then current, because it certainly wasn't needed. And it didn't have the visceral impact of, let's say, Norman trying to grab the knife in Meg Tilly's hands when she was trying to keep him away from her. And you saw his hands getting cut as he tried to grab it from her. That's horrifying, and that came out of the dramatic moment, and that felt right. The knife in the mouth was gratuitous.
Towering above any missteps is returning star Anthony Perkins. He was usually the romantic interest before Hitchcock came along, and his performance in Psycho ensured that no one would buy him as anyone but Norman Bates. Not for the first time, an actor found himself typecast by his most famous role. And for years, Perkins carried a deepening resentment for Psycho and Dear Old Norman.
When you did the first Psycho, did that help or hurt your career?
Well, it hurt it in that people started associating me with that kind of role. It helped it because people could, rather than saying, here comes what's-his-name down the street, they were able to put a name to the face. So it did both those things.
And what do you think Psycho 2 will do to your career?
Well, I've long since tried to forget about disassociating myself with the specter of Norman Bates, so I've got to give into that rather than resist it. It doesn't bother me anymore. I have more confidence in myself now that I'm older and have a family. I don't feel quite so remote and alone in the world as Norman did. I feel more a part of the world.
Perkins is excellent throughout, carrying the film as its star and making Norman's journey utterly compelling. We really feel the good in him and genuinely want him to get better. It's all summed up in Norman's heartfelt scenes with Miss Samuels, one of which the actor insisted Holland insert into the script.
Just don't let them take me back to the institution. All right?
Don't worry, Norman, I won't.
You smell good.
I do?
Yeah.
What do I smell?
You smell like the toasted cheese sandwiches.
What?
That my mother used to bring me when I was in bed with a temperature. She used to do lots of nice things for me before she became.
Shh. Just remember the good things she did for you. Only the good things.
I can't. They're not there anymore.
Of course they're there.
No, the doctors took them all away, along with everything else.
The only request came about halfway through shooting. And Tony asked for a scene, a few moments with Meg Tilly in the bedroom. And it's the toasted cheese scene. I would have called it a grilled cheese sandwich because that's what we say in America. But because it was Richard, they said toasted cheese in Australia. So I called it toasted cheese. And it was to show Tony reaching out and show how much he cared for Meg. And I think that although it wasn't specific, you get that idea from watching it, and it makes you care more for Norman. The other moment that he asked for, and Richard gave it to him, it was a visual moment of Tony looking at himself in the mirror. And I never knew what the hell it meant. I didn't have it in the script. Tony wanted it, and it stayed in, and I still don't know what it meant.
Do you have a knife?
No, I'm afraid. I don't. I just moved back here after being many years away, and I forgot to bring any cutlery.
In this particular movie, in Psycho 2, where you choke on the word cutlery, was that your idea or the director's?
Well, it was my idea, and I don't know if I can really summarize this quickly. When I was brought in to see a couple of the girls that they were considering for the role, this was well in advance of filming, suddenly, without warning, they asked if I would be willing to tape some film so they could see both girls kind of in action. And I realized that I was going to have to come up with something of the Norman Bates characterization. I hadn't really thought about what I was going to do. I had some ideas, but I didn't realize that suddenly I was going to have to act the part. And sure enough, just as we were running it with this girl, one of these girls, this hesitation on the word cutlery occurred. So it was almost as if I slipped back into the characterization quite spontaneously.
It's little surprise that Perkins would eventually embrace being Norman Bates, although his stipulation for returning for the far less successful Psycho 3 would be the chance to direct it.
Universal didn't give him his back end, even though the movie had made something like $90 million and only cost $5 million. And so he threatened to sue them. And one of the top executives, I think maybe it was Tom Mount, I don't know, called him up and said that if he didn't drop the suit, he'd never work in Hollywood again. And Tony laughed and said, yeah, until you need me the next time. And so, of course, when they came back to him for Psycho 3, his price for it was that he direct. And Tony had an art house or European sensibility. It wasn't a narrative sensibility, and there wasn't a sense of how to scare people or frighten people or do suspense. What he had was a European mood, a moodiness to his work.
Psycho 3 is exactly what many would have rationally expected from the second film, a more routine slasher effort in which Norman is clearly doing all the murders, although Perkins displayed an amazing visual sense that raised it above most of the competition. Beginning with a tribute to Hitchcock's Vertigo, Psycho 3 is frustratingly generic, but no less steeped in the language of film, often having more to do with the work of Dario Argento than old Hitch. Screenwriter Charles Edward Pogue also took the opportunity to retcon the most divisive element of Part 2.
What set you off again, Norman? Mrs. Fool? You killed her, didn't you? What did she do? Come to you, tell you that she was your mother? She was crazy, Norman, but she wasn't your mother. Neither are you! Mrs. Fool was your aunt, Norman. She was in love with your father, but your mother stole him away from her!
Mrs. Fool killed your father in a jealous rage and kidnapped you when you were just a baby!
Even the release of 1990's Psycho 4, The Beginning, wasn't enough to replace Franklin's effort as the best sequel. Made for television, the sequel/prequel by Mick Garris is an entertaining watch, delving into the relationship Norman had with his mother before he poisoned her with strychnine. Returning screenwriter Joseph Stefano took it upon himself to ignore the previous two efforts, and we are unsure if the present-day footage represents Norman's second release from care, or his first. And these aren't the only sequels. Block would pen his own follow-ups, and Psycho 2 would appear a year earlier in 1982. Prefiguring the postmodernism of Scream, it focused on Bates travelling to Hollywood to interfere with a movie being made about his life. It was as unexpected as the movie follow-up, having the guts to kill off Norman and replace him with someone else.
I sat with him on a panel at the Writers Guild with Robert Block. Block made the horrendous decision to kill Norman Bates off in the first 10 or 15 or 20 pages. And it was like, oh my God, who wants to see Psycho and not see Norman Bates?
Psycho 2 got generally mixed appraisals in 1983, but was a hit at the box office, coming in second to Return of the Jedi on its opening weekend. Its reputation as an overlooked gem has slowly increased over the years, with many considering it one of the finest horror sequels ever produced. It is a film that deserves to be rediscovered by those actually willing to take the plunge, an announcement that sequels don't need to be pedestrian or safe to be hugely popular. In fact, even Quentin Tarantino would call it one of his favourite films, and a sequel he watches more than the original. It is the inspired move of making Norman our star, and our truly unexpected hero. You can't help but feel that, if he had lived to see it, Hitch would have approved.
I know how it is, Mother. You've had a long day and you must be tired. I'll just put you to bed and tuck you in for the night. I'll even say your prayers for you. Would you like that?
I'm not sleepy. Put me in my chair.
Yes, Mother.
Now, turn me to the window. I want to keep my eyes on you. Make sure you don't start playing with filthy girls again.
Yes, Mother.
Good. Well, what are you gawking at? Go downstairs and open the motel. What do you expect us to live on, Hope?
No, Mother.
Remember, Norman, I'm the only one who loves you. Only your mother truly loves you.